Hello and welcome to Daily on Defense Monday Briefing. I'm Dave Brown, and with me is Jamie McIntyre. Jacqueline Klimas is on assignment covering the three service secretaries, so we'll be looking forward to coverage of that. But first, it was a busy weekend for Defense Secretary Ash Carter. He was in Iraq getting an update on the Mosul situation. Why don't you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, you know, whenever the secretary drops down in Iraq, they always refer to it as like a surprise visit. But, you know, obviously,
Right. They
all really know he's coming. We just don't say anything about it. And he's there at the point where the Mosul offensive, the offensive to liberate Mosul by Iraqi troops is at a key point. He was meeting both with the Iraqi prime minister and also the Kurdish leaders who are also there, and also his top commanders, to get an update on how things are going. And right now, it appears that things are still slightly ahead of schedule. The Kurds in particular, who have always been the most effective fighters, seem to be achieving their objectives.
A little bit faster.
Liberating
than
their cities from the east. The Iraqi forces coming up from the south are meeting more resistance, taking them a little longer. They're still about 50 miles outside of Mosul. But it's going to take some time, probably at least a couple of weeks. But at this point, things are pretty much going according to plan.
Right. And as with everything right now, it has a political dimension. I just want to look at this. This weekend, Donald Trump tweeted out, "The attack on Mosul is turning out to be a total disaster. We gave them months of notice. U.S. is looking so dumb. Vote Trump and win again." What's your take on that after talking to a lot of people and getting these updates over the weekend?
I think it's hard to make the case that it's a total disaster, but it is a very, very tough fight. This is not the kind of clean, easy victory, say, that the United States had back in the 1991 Persian Gulf War,
where
there's 4 days, you sweep to victory, and everyone's happy. This is very brutal combat. The Islamic State fighters in Mosul are doing all kinds of things. They're executing civilians. When they catch people who are celebrating the fact that some of these villages have been liberated, they're executing some of them. They're lighting a sulfur pit on fire. They're doing everything possible to make this as difficult. So this is going to be a very dangerous, dirty fight as they head into the center of Mosul over the next couple of weeks.
Right, and one of Secretary Carter's goals when he was there was to secure an agreement between Turkey and Iraq, to the extent to which Turkish troops are allowed to take part in the offensive on Mosul, and that hasn't gone so well.
So the United States has a big problem. They've got two key allies here. They need Turkey. Turkey's a NATO ally. The United States uses the base at Incirlik for operations. They need to keep Turkey happy. And they also obviously need to keep Iraq happy, because Iraq is the one who's doing the fighting on the ground in the Mosul operation. And these two countries are in a bitter feud. The president of Turkey, President Erdogan, believes that Turkey should have a historic role in playing a role in liberating Mosul. Iraq doesn't want anybody in its country without its permission. And, you know, the United States makes a point of saying pretty much at every time they talk about what they're doing that it's at the invitation of the Iraqi government. Turkey's got about 500 troops north of Mosul that they've been using to sort of train and equip the
Kurdish fighters. And they're still there, right?
And they're still there. And Iraq wants them out. Turkey says, we're not going out. It's a sovereignty issue. Carter landed in Ankara and said, hey, problem solved. I've reached an agreement in principle, we're going to resolve all this. Don't worry about it. And then he went to Iraq, and they said, "Nah, that's not working for us." So the U.S. still has these two rivals at each other. So, you know, I guess that's why Carter is Secretary of Defense and not Secretary of State, because this diplomatic effort clearly fell flat.
And after Iraq, he has other traveling to do. Also on the schedule this week, he's going to France and also to Belgium. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so in France, he's meeting with the other countries that are part of the counter-Islamic State coalition, the ones that are most directly contributing to the effort in Iraq and Syria, and they're meeting in Paris. Mm-hmm. And then he'll be going to NATO for the regular NATO defense ministers meeting. That's where all the NATO defense ministers get together and talk. And of course, there's a lot of cross-pollination going on there. So he'll have another opportunity, by the way, to talk to the Turks and the Iraqis about the problems that they're facing, both in Paris, because both of them will be represented there, and also at the NATO minister meeting. So maybe you'll have another chance to try to smooth things over.
Sure, and elsewhere on the military beat, this is one of those things they call a talker. Over the weekend, the LA Times reported that there's any number of soldiers in California who are given bonuses, enlistment bonuses. It turns out they're being forced to repay them. Talk a little bit about that.
So these soldiers and other military personnel got bonuses Often they went back into a war zone to continue risking their lives. It turns out that the bonuses were only supposed to be for some very special high demand occupations, but recruiters were giving them out to other people so that they weren't legal. Now they have to pay them back. And the Pentagon says, look, we don't have any choice. We have to ask for this money back. But it's outrageous because the people penalized are the people who had no, you know, they were given the bonuses.
That's correct.
They didn't know it was a mistake. And now, you know, and okay, so some of them are $15,000, doesn't sound like a lot of money. That's enough money to put some of these veterans in severe financial straits.
That's correct, and so, it's not like that money was just sitting in a little box somewhere. Most likely it was used, invested.
You know, one would think that the United States government could find a way to forgive that debt, given the circumstances and given the fact that this was not something that they were trying to cheat the government out of. And I guess Kevin McCarthy, the House Majority Leader, is already talking about calling some hearings together, asking the military to go back and look at it again. Because really, I think this is the kind of bipartisan issue that no matter how you look at this, it really does seem outrageous.
Right. The optics don't look so good. Make sure you stay with WashingtonExaminer.com throughout the week and sign up for our daily newsletter at dailyondefense.com.